Turning now to the ongoing strike in Hollywood. Talks between studios and negotiators for Hollywood actors resume next week, and the first such meetings in months. This after the writers' union struck a tentative deal with studios earlier this week after 5 months of failed negotiations. The SAG-AFTRA Actors' Union, which has around 160,000 members, walked off the job in July, asking for higher pay and for curbs on the use of artificial intelligence in entertainment. Other demands from actors include limits on self-tape auditions and used in casting. They also want hair and makeup artists who can work with various hair textures and skin tones to ensure equity for all performers.
I want to celebrate what SAG-AFTRA holds as its superpower, our diversity.
Yeah! Yeah.
Our categorical inclusion of all types of work in this union and those who represent it. It is the thing that makes this country great.
Yeah.
It's the thing that makes this struggle righteous. Yeah. It's the thing that makes SAG-AFTRA a powerful vision of what America must, should, and can be.
U.S. President Joe Biden delivers a blistering attack against his potential 2024 rival, former U.S. President Donald Trump. During a speech in Temple, Arizona, Biden warned of the danger posed by Trump, as exemplified in the U.S. Capitol riots in January 2021, if his leading Republican challenger returns to the White House. Biden adds the U.S. faces a threat to its democracy brought about by Republican extremists.
And there's something dangerous happening in America now. There's an extremist movement that does not share the basic beliefs in our democracy, the MAGA movement. Not every Republican, not even a majority of Republicans, adhere to the MAGA extremist ideology. I know because I've been able to work with Republicans my whole career. My friends, they're not hiding their attacks. They're openly promoting them, attacking the free press as the enemy of the people, attacking the rule of law as an impediment, fomenting voter suppression and election subversion. Did you ever think we'd be having debates at your stage of your careers where banning books and burying history? Extremists in Congress more determined to shut down the government, to burn the place down, than to let the people's business be done.
Biden made his remarks at an event meant to honor the late Republican Senator John McCain, one of the most vocal critics of Trump, before his death in 2018. House Republicans hold their first hearing on their impeachment inquiry into U.S. President Joe Biden. They are accusing Biden of lying about the business dealings of his troubled son, Hunter. But they failed to provide new information about Biden's alleged financial ties to his son.
For years, President Biden has lied to the American people about his knowledge of and participation in his family's corrupt business schemes. At least 10 times, Joe Biden lied to the American people that he never spoke to his family about their business dealings. He lied by telling the American people that there was an absolute wall between his official government duties and his personal life. Let's be clear. There was no wall. The door was wide open to those who purchased what a business associate described as the Biden brand.
Democrats, meanwhile, insist there's no evidence of any wrongdoing committed by Biden.
This impeachment inquiry was a result of President Trump's pressure. So we moved from a Trump-ordered government shutdown to a Trump-ordered impeachment process, and yet back in the reality-based world, the majority sits completely empty-handed with no evidence of any presidential wrongdoing, no smoking gun, no gun, no smoke. In fact, we have had to slide awkwardly into a House impeachment process without the benefit of the floor vote that Speaker McCarthy insisted was absolutely imperative and necessary when Donald Trump was impeached.
House Republicans opened their impeachment inquiry just as the odds of a government shutdown grow. The U.S. Congress only has 3 days left to reach a deal. On Thursday, the Democratic-led U.S. Senate forged ahead with a bipartisan stopgap funding bill aimed at averting a fourth partial government shutdown in a decade. The House, meanwhile, prepared a vote on partisan Republican spending bill with no chance of becoming a law. These different paths increase the chances of federal agencies running out of money on October 1st, furloughing hundreds of thousands of workers and halting a wide range of services. The White House says they have a contingency plan in place to keep essential services running.
We continue to work through that planning in the coming days to make decisions about what functions are essential, what functions are essential to national security that cannot be suspended even in the case of a shutdown, and what functions unfortunately do have to be suspended while a shutdown continues. That said, we remain hopeful that Congress will do its job and fund the government, but we are making contingency planning in case they don't.
Let's find out the stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now. Our Bureau Chief, DJ Manotok.
Good morning, Nikki. Here are the top stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community in North America. We begin with a Filipino man accused of operating an agency that arranged hundreds of sham marriages for immigration purposes, pleading guilty to conspiracy to commit marriage fraud and immigration document fraud. Marcianito Biol Benitez, known as Mars, was arrested in April of last year for arranging sham marriages and submitting fraudulent green card applications for over 600 non-U.S. citizens. Benitez operated out of his Los Angeles office. The case saw a total of 11 defendants, including 6 Philippine nationals, each charged with one count of conspiracy to commit marriage fraud and immigration document fraud. Under the alleged scheme, Benitez's co-defendants would help file the paperwork while others would refer clients to Benitez's agency. The agency would then stage wedding ceremonies and coach clients and spouses on their interviews with U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services. Clients would then pay them a fee of $20,000 to $35,000. Meanwhile, tattoo enthusiasts and the best tattoo artists from across Canada recently flocked to Toronto for the Dutdutan Tattoo Convention. The event, organized by Tala Entertainment, was held in Canada for the first time in 23 years. Dutdutan Tattoo Convention was established in the Philippines and has since celebrated the art of tattooing and music.
Dutdutan was a term coined by Alfred Guevara, the founder of Dutdutan. It was a term used to tattoo. Tala Entertainment has shown interest and proved to everybody that they could also handle their own version of Dutdutan. This is the prodigy.
The highlight of Dutdutan was the highly anticipated tattoo competition.
Nag-usap ko na kung sino ang interested maging model ko ngayong Dutdutan.
Ali po, yung artist ko po yung may design na neo-traditional.
It's time. America has voted.
And finally, Pinoy pride reigned supreme at America's Got Talent as New Jersey Filipina Ana de Guzman was declared runner-up in America's Got Talent on Thursday.
Did you all get the Queen of Hearts? Queen of Hearts? Queen of Hearts, judges?
The 25-year-old magician had a strong finale showing on Wednesday, getting praise from all 4 judges with her card trick. She made the Queen of Hearts, chosen randomly by host Terry Crews, appear not only in the sealed envelopes of all AGT judges, but also in the envelopes of every audience member.
I've got the Queen of Hearts. So how the hell did you do that?
It's magic!
That is magic! I mean, that was unbelievable.
De Guzman, who already made history by being the first female magician to make it to the AGT finals, had her mother in the audience as she flew in from the Philippines to show her support. And those are the stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community in North America. For more news from TFC News, log on to our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News, on our ABS-CBN YouTube channel, and on our ABS-CBN News app on your smartphones and tablets. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to Nikki for the rundown.
China's a growing aggression front and center during a U.S. House hearing on Beijing's actions in the South China Sea. The U.S. House Committee on Foreign Affairs opened the probe Thursday to expose China's illegal activities in the Indo-Pacific region. They reaffirmed Washington's commitment to help ensure peace and stability in the region amid China's bullying tactics. The Philippines has been on the receiving end of China's aggression, its Coast Guard using water cannons and lasers to drive away Philippine vessels.
The Chinese Communist Party has long maintained illegal claims in the South China Sea, spreading propaganda about its notorious nine-dash line, which is now 10 dashes because they added a dash around Taiwan. Across the South China Sea, China has illegally dredged nearly 3,200 acres of new land, some of which serve as military outposts. These artificial islands allow the CCP's Coast Guard to maintain a permanent presence in the exclusive economic zones of our allies and partners. Further, illegal and unregulated fishing activities destroying the environment. This was clearly a bullying tactic, intimidation tactic. Congress must take the CCP's aggression in the South China Sea seriously and ensure that our allied nations and are getting the assurances from the administration that they need.
Members of the U.S. Coast Guard, as well as the State and Defense Departments, also vowed continuous support to their Indo-Pacific allies.
While our allies and partners have taken great steps to stand up for our shared vision, DoD is also taking an increasingly proactive approach to counter PRC coercion. Since 2016, the department has allocated over $475 million in capabilities that enable Southeast Asian partners to sense, share, and contribute to regional maritime security. And we are laser focused on identifying new and cost-effective emerging technologies that will bring greater capability to our allies and partners more quickly.
Aggressive fishing practices and natural resource exploitation undermine territorial sovereignty and economic prosperity of Indo-Pacific countries. As a counter to these malign activities, the United States Coast Guard has been and is now operating and engaging throughout the region to promote maritime governance. We are trusted to support partners as they deter, disrupt, and defeat threats and challenges.
China's claims most of the South China Sea, overlapping with the exclusive economic zones of the Philippines, Vietnam, Malaysia, Brunei, and Indonesia. But Manila's 2016 arbitral victory already invalidated China's sweeping claims. Filipino fishermen asking government for equipment and security so they can help document Chinese aggression in the West Philippine Sea. The Bigis Namangin Staff Federation met with key government agencies to propose the move. But some of the fishermen admit they are afraid of possible retaliation from China's Coast Guard if they are caught taking videos.
Habang binabaybay po namin yung ano, sa gilid lang po kami dumadaan, malayo-malayo po, mga 5 milya po siguro yung layo po sa bahura po ng Scarborough. Doon na po, inano po kami, sinusundan-sundan na po kami. Tapos binibilisan na po ng pag-ano ng papa ko yung takbo po namin para di po kami mabutan. Kasi po, may dadala po kaming staff po nyo. Yung kinakatakot ko yung kaya po yung, habang nabibidyo po ako yun, nakatago lang po yung cellphone ko lang po yung nakalabas. Habang binibidyo ko po yun.
The Justice Department, meanwhile, says the legal cluster of the cabinet has been meeting to discuss a possible case against China. Aside from the Permanent Court of Arbitration, they are eyeing to approach the International Court of Justice.
It's a matter of choosing the complaint to be filed and where to file the complaint. That will be discussed properly. But I think that I am more inclined to file it with the PCA because they have the familiarity and the institutional memory to handle cases about the West Philippine Sea.
Let's get an update on the weather now from Pag-asa forecaster Rhea Torres. Good morning, Rhea. What should we expect this coming weekend?
Yes, good morning to you as well, Nikki, as well as to our televiewers. As of the moment, we are currently monitoring a low-pressure area outside our Philippine area of responsibility. And right now, we are not ruling out the possibility of it developing into a tropical cyclone. Although, as of the moment, it still has no direct effect on any parts of the country. However, its trough or its extension, along with the southwest monsoon, will be bringing rainy weather or cloudy weather, as well as scattered rain showers and thunderstorms over large portions of Visayas and Palawan, as well as Zamboanga Peninsula. Meanwhile, for Metro Manila as well as the rest of the country, generally fair weather conditions may be expected, although there are still chances of isolated rain showers or thunderstorms, usually by the afternoon or the evening. Over this coming weekend, the hot and humid weather may persist over large portions of Luzon as well as Mindanao, although still due to the effects of the trough of the low-pressure area as well as southwest monsoon, rainy weather may still persist over large portions of Visayas and Palawan area. And we currently have no gale warning raised over the seabirds of our country. Therefore, for our fisher folks and those with small sea crafts, are still to freely venture out into the sea. And that is the latest here from Pag-asa Weather Forecasting Center. This is Rhea Torres reporting.
Thanks as always, Rhea.